Hachette Audio presents Some New Kind of Kick, a memoir. Written by Kid Congo Powers with Chris Campion. Read by Kid Congo Powers and Raphael Corkhill.
For Ryan, who inspires me every second of every day with his endless love and encouragement. Life is short, filled with stuff. Don't know what for. I ain't had enough. I want some new kind of kick. Lux Interior.
Introduction by JON SAVAGE. Kid Congo Powers is cool. At the age of 14, when he was still Brian Tristan, he got to see the New York Dolls in their first pomp. At the age of 15, he became a regular at Rodney's infamous glam slam English disco. In 1976, when he was 17, he rushed out to buy the Ramones album on the first day of release. They were, as he writes, a dream fulfilled. Later that year, just after his cousin Teresa was killed by unknown assailants, he started the West Coast branch of their fan club and found his own tribe of outcasts. By 1977, he was an insider in that extraordinary lost youth subculture, the Los Angeles punk scene, becoming the fan club president for that most hermetic and futuristic of groups, the Screamers. After setting up the Gun Club with Jeffrey Pierce, he was asked to join the Cramps, with whom he stayed for 3 years, playing on their definitive second album, Psychedelic Jungle. When he left the group's prescriptive world, it felt like escaping a cult. Jumping from the frying pan into the fire, he then joined Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds. Kid Congo Powers is gay. Like many of us, he was liberated by the arrival of David Bowie in 1972. There could hardly have been a more perfect fantasy figure and foil for a gay teenager at the time than David Bowie. He was a rock star, of course, but androgynous to the extreme, both asexual and openly hedonistic. He was like an alien from outer space, which was exactly the experience of a gay teenager at the time, dispossessed on a hostile planet far from home. This was something that wasn't much talked about in the late 70s punk world. People did it, people had sex, but they didn't join the mainstream gay world of disco with its more open approach to the topic. We wanted to scare the hell out of everyone and shake up the status quo. For us gay kids, that meant the homosexual status quo. We did not fit into the clone or disco mentality of late 70s gay culture, nor did we want to. As first-wave punk rock gays, we weren't interested in being out either. There was a ready-made affirmative gay world out there, but punks rejected it. Perhaps it was in a strange way too mainstream, too regimented, too straight. Or perhaps punk was the perfect place for those who were not ready to address their sexuality, who were happy to subsume themselves into a wider weirdness that could cloak who they really were. Whichever way, punk was not an ideal place to explore a sexuality that was still ill understood, still taboo, particularly once the jocks and the skinheads arrived. Gay punks were double outsiders. Like many teens at that time, Brian Tristan took a trip into the dark side, dabbling with heroin, living in a succession of 24/7 party houses, fueled by a never-ending diet of drugs and alcohol. Renamed Kid Congo Powers by the Cramps in 1980, he embarked on a 20-year trip of drunkenness and heroin addiction, recovery and relapse, before a series of tragedies, the death of his father, of several friends from AIDS, of his musical partner and soulmate Jeffrey Pierce, brought him to the naked lunch at the end of that particular fork. Unprocessed grief and denial of his sexuality had brought him to this point. In London, I would go to gay bars and pick up people. I didn't have relationships. I was getting blackout drunk and sleeping with people. He writes, intimacy was alien to me, Not physical intimacy, emotional intimacy. I didn't realize until then how much I'd suppressed my true self as a heroin addict, contorting myself into this asexual posture that was very unnatural and extremely silly. Kid Congo Powers is a survivor. Even in the darkest debauch, he is saved by some kind of innocence, a self-starter get-up-and-go, and perhaps simple sheer luck. The book ends in 1997 with his final release from heroin, but I suspect and hope that he has entered his 60s as a happy man, having, like many of us again, finally escaped the self-hatred and self-denial that being born gay in the 1950s engendered. What he had to go through to get to this point is in this book.
Part 1, Chapter 1, The Feminine Bridge. They say some people are born under a bad sign. I was born under a bad bridge. Well, not bad, just mixed up and wrong. A bridge that couldn't decide whether it was male or female. I grew up in La Puente, California, a largely Hispanic suburb east of Los Angeles. Whoever named the town must have flunked first grade Spanish, simply misheard what someone else said, or maybe didn't even speak a word, because a bridge is always, without fail, male. But we were named La Puente. Ours was female. Was it bisexual, transsexual, pansexual, gender fluid? And where was this bridge? There was no bridge that I knew of in La Puente, not even a river to cross. But that wasn't the only neighborhood misnomer causing me confusion as a child. A few blocks from my home was the City of Industry, the next town along from La Puente. Only, it didn't smell like oil and dust, but tomato ketchup and strawberry jam that wafted out of the Kearns factory abutting the train tracks at the end of East Temple Avenue. An invisible, fragrant cloud hung over the entire area, inducing an olfactory schizophrenia in the local population. On strawberry jam days, life was sweet, without a care in the world. On tomato ketchup days, for some reason, people were crabbier. Perhaps it was made from a deadly nightshade. My sister Barbara worked down the road from Kearns, at the Mattel toy factory. Now there was my kind of industry. In my imagination, she worked on the production line in a Willy Wonka wonderland, alongside green-haired troll dolls, tinkering away, making toys galore. In reality, the Mattel factory was your run-of-the-mill urban sweatshop. "I hate my job," was a common refrain from my big sis when she got home from work, exhausted by the mundane daily drudgery. I happily ignored her reality check for my fantasy, because she would often bring home discarded seconds and broken or misshapen Hot Wheels cars, so much the rage for little boys at the time. They were going to throw these in the garbage, she'd tell me. I worked too hard to see them trashed. I figured you might be able to play with them anyway. Given that most of the muscle cars I was gifted usually had no more than three wheels and were so banged up they had doors or interiors missing, it was difficult to play with them in the way Mattel intended. I created my own entertainment. Those broken-up vehicles just happened to be perfect for playing demolition derby. I would smash them together and send them careening over the end of a table to some terrible demise. I think I was probably inspired by my love for the commercials I used to see on TV for the nearby Irwindale Speedway, where supercharged, customized hot rods raced along the strip every weekend. The commercials were a riot of noise and a real turn-on, motors revving, cars colliding, and the announcer screaming his lungs out on top of it all. Barb also used to bring me tons of warped pieces of plastic tracks with hairpin twists and turns, which afforded me hours of fun creating endless roads to nowhere, my favorite destination. La Puente's road to nowhere arched north to our freeway overpass, the closest thing we had to a genderless bridge, and landed right in the middle of Helltown. At least, that's what my mother told me they used to call Baldwin Park in the 50s, because it was the place you went to partake in any sinful activity involving drugs, prostitutes, and guns. Thanks for the tip, Mom. If you were lucky enough to crawl out of Helltown on your hands and knees and back to the overpass, a meditative respite awaited you. Just two blocks from our family abode was a solemn-looking red brick building with a perfectly manicured lawn outside. You never saw anybody going in or out of its front doors. This was the borough's corporation building. A nightmare-inducing Twilight Zone episode to some, the borough's corporation was a zen garden to me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.